Chapter 5, Water for Life, Part 3. In this lecture, we'll be talking about the names and formulas of ionic compounds, the ocean, how it's an aqueous solution, essentially, and covalent compounds and their solutions. Now, in naming ionic compounds, we're going to look first at the main group elements. We can always predict the charge formed when certain atoms are in an ionic compound. And it has to do with the stability of noble gases and those atoms wanting to achieve a full octet just like the noble gases. So here we have the halogens. And so in order to have a favorable reaction and form an ionic compound, they'll want to obtain one single electron in order to complete their octet. So when they form an ionic compound, they take a charge of -1. Oxygen and sulfur need two electrons, so they take a charge of -2. Nitrogen, a charge of -3. Aluminum is close enough to the metal side that it is easier for it to lose 3 electrons and achieve an octet than gain 5. One way to think of it as well is our nonmetals will always gain electrons and metals will always lose electrons. The same is true with the alkali metals and the alkaline earth metals. The alkali metals will always lose one electron to achieve an octet and a noble gas configuration. Sodium loses one electron to have the same number of electrons as neon. Magnesium would need to lose 2. You should note the trends and remember the charges these atoms will take when forming an ionic compound. There are other types of ions we find in nature as well, something called polyatomic ions. These are atoms covalently bonded to one another in such a way that the net group of atoms has an ionic charge. So OH minus hydroxide, for example, has an oxygen covalently bonded to a hydrogen, yet that chemical species, when taken as a whole, has a -1 ionic charge. Can you predict which atoms will form polyatomic ions? Not at this level. We essentially memorize these polyatomic ions and their names and their charges. I would recommend making flashcards and memorize them in order to finish your exams in the allocated time. You may also look at them and use them as notes, perhaps depending on your instructor. So be sure to clarify if you're allowed to use a table of polyatomic ions or not. When ionic compounds made of polyatomic ions dissolve in solution, the polyatomic ions remain intact. For example, sodium sulfate with the 2 sodium ions for one formula unit, we would get 2 sodium ions. If you had an ionic compound, truly you would get many more, but the ratio is still 2 sodium ions to 1 sulfate ion. But the sulfate ion remains intact. You don't have sulfur and oxygen flying around willy-nilly in solution. Let's watch a video on how to name ionic compounds. Thinker Buddy, name the following compounds and determine the compound formula from the name. We have NaNO2, FeOH, parentheses 2, so 2 OH groups, Li2SO3, NH4, OH. And then determine the compound formula for magnesium fluoride, sodium sulfate, ammonium sulfide, and potassium carbonate. Let's start with the first compound, sodium, and then NO2 minus is our nitrite polyatomic ion. Then we have iron, and iron is a transition metal, so we need to indicate the charge because transition metals can have variable charge. So we use a Roman numeral 2, and then that's the hydroxide polyatomic ion, so iron 2 hydroxide. Lithium, and then we have the sulfite polyatomic ion. With ionic compounds, you never need to use a prefix to indicate the number of polyatomic ions or metal ions. We assume we know how many or the ratio between the two because we know the charge. Our final compound to be named is ammonium hydroxide. You can have ionic compounds formed between a positive polyatomic ion and a negatively charged polyatomic ion. You just list them one after the other. Now let's determine the compound formula from the name. First thing to do is to write the iron. Let's now determine the compound formula from the name. The first thing to do is list the ions in the compound. We have magnesium, which always takes a 2 plus charge. We have fluorine, which always takes a minus 1 charge. And then let's try doing just switching the subscripts and the charges. MgF2, magnesium fluoride. Lithium sulfate, we have lithium plus, it's in the alkali metal group 1, it always takes a plus 1 charge. Sulfate, 2 minus, switch the subscripts for the charges or vice versa. So we get lithium subscript 2, sulfate, SO4. Be sure you don't include the charges in the final ionic compound formula. Ammonium, NH4 plus. Sulfide, that's our sulfur anion, S2 minus. Let's do the charge again, but this time since we're working with a polyatomic ion, we have to put it in parentheses. The only time you put a polyatomic ion in parentheses is if there is more than one of them. Our last one, potassium, group 1, so it takes a plus 1 charge. Carbonate, we just have to memorize. It's CO3, 2 minus. Do the old switcheroo. Okay, and we have K2CO3. Let's take a look at an animation on the solubility of ionic compounds.
Let's add a small amount of table salt, sodium chloride, to water. As you know, sodium chloride dissolves in water. Click on the zoom button to view sodium. Polar water molecules interact. Let's add a small amount of table salt, sodium chloride, to water. As you know, sodium chloride dissolves in water. Click on the zoom button to view sodium chloride dissolving in water on a microscopic scale. Polar water molecules interact with the positive and negative ions of a salt. The positive ends of the water molecules are attracted to the negative chloride ions. The negative ends of the water molecules are attracted to the positive sodium ions. This interaction between water and the salt ions causes a salt to break apart or dissolve in water.
When you dissolve an ionic compound in water, it has to be pulled apart by water molecules, with the partial negative charge surrounding the positive ions and the partial positive on the hydrogen atom surrounding the negative ions. We can describe that using a chemical formula. NaCl solid, put water over the arrow, dissociates when it dissolves into sodium ion and chloride anion. A good rule of thumb in determining the solubility of ionic compounds is the higher the charge on the ions, the more likely it is going to be insoluble. It's a rough rule of thumb. If you're ever asked to predict solubility, though, solubility tables will be given, such as this one here, where it lists the ions. And when you have a sodium, potassium, or ammonium ion in any ionic compound, it will always be soluble. Same thing with the nitrate. Chlorides, when you have Cl- in an ionic compound, most of them are soluble, but there's exceptions. Silver chloride is insoluble, and so on and so forth. Most carbonates are insoluble, with some exceptions. And what we mean by insoluble, in order to set an arbitrary line, is anything that when you put it into water, its concentration of ions would be less than 0.01 molar. Let's now take a look at how covalent molecules dissolve in water.
Let's add a small amount of methanol, CH3OH, to water. Methanol dissolves in water. Click on the zoom in button to view methanol dissolving in water on a microscopic scale. Methanol molecules contain a polar OH group. The oxygen has a partial negative charge and the hydrogen has a partial positive charge. This charge separation is called a dipole. Methanol molecules are attracted to each other through the interaction of the dipole of one molecule with the dipole of another molecule. Water is also polar, and the dipole of water will interact with the dipole of methanol. The attractions between water molecules and a methanol molecule will break the attractions between methanol molecules, causing methanol to dissolve in water. Note that upon dissolving, the covalent methanol molecules remain intact. Compare this to the dissolution of an ionic compound such as sodium chloride, NaCl, which breaks apart into its component ions in water.
So, to summarize, when you have a covalent molecule, in the example you saw, it was methanol, but sugar, or sucrose, is very similar. When surrounded in solution by water molecules, it's the partial negative charge on the oxygen atom attracted to the positive partial on the sugar molecule. Covalent molecules, unlike ionic compounds, remain intact when dissolved into solution. They do not separate or dissociate, and they will not conduct electricity because they do not form ions. Unless you're talking about an acid or a base, and we'll talk about that in another chapter. Now, there is one other rule of thumb in determining whether or not something will dissolve in another compound or molecule. First, see if you can remember the structure of N-octane, the unbranched octane molecule. Octane, the oct, like octopus, indicates it has 8 carbon atoms. You can do the Lewis structure, or here we often replace the bonding electrons with single lines. Now, octane, we know, or oil, does not mix with water. And our rule of thumb is molecules that are polar will dissolve in polar substances, or molecules capable of hydrogen bonding will dissolve in substances capable of hydrogen bonding. Octane has no electronegative groups. The difference in electronegativity between carbon and hydrogen is so small that we essentially call that a nonpolar bond, and this molecule is nonpolar. There's no phon atom, no fluorine, oxygen, or nitrogen, so it's not capable of hydrogen bonding. Like dissolves like, but in this case, since oil and water are so different, and we're assuming the oil is octane, which is a big assumption, but it has molecules similar to octane, since they're so unlike, they are insoluble in one another. Methanol, on the other hand, like you saw, which has a phon atom, an O, connected to an H, is capable of hydrogen bonding, and therefore methanol dissolves in water. Thinker buddy, how does the adding of a covalent compound to water differ from that of an ionic compound? A, in an ionic compound, if it is soluble, ions will dissociate and be surrounded by the water molecules. B, covalent molecules may interact with the partial charges on water, but will typically not form ions. C, covalent molecules such as hydrocarbons are unlike water and therefore will not mix. D, all of the above are true. The correct answer is D, all of the above are true. This ends the third part of Chapter 5.